Hey there, geologists! Bee here from the Miaverse. I hope you're excited because today we're going to be exploring some really wild-looking rock formations. I mean, look at this thing! Or what about this one? Or this? Do these formations really occur naturally on Earth? Today, we'll be exploring the processes that make these unique features possible. Physical and chemical weathering. Are you ready, geologists? Let's get to digging! Let's take a look at this old statue. What observations do you have about its condition? Pause and record your thoughts in your notes. You might have noted that it looks physically worn down or that it's discolored in places. These changes are caused by weathering, a natural process where rocks and minerals are broken down over time. Physical weathering breaks down rocks without changing their chemical composition. A common example of physical weathering is wind. In deserts and other open areas, wind can pick up small particles of sand and dust. These particles act like sandpaper, grinding against larger rocks and wearing them down over long periods of time. Chemical weathering, on the other hand, breaks down rocks by changing their chemical composition. It happens when minerals in the rocks react with substances like water, oxygen, acids, and carbon dioxide, weakening or dissolving the rock over time. There are a variety of factors that influence both physical and chemical weathering, and the first we'll discuss is the atmosphere. The atmosphere consists of the air that surrounds the Earth, and this mixture of gases plays a large role in determining weather patterns. Weather and weathering? Geologists, what do you think is the relationship between these two things? Pause and record your thoughts in your notes. As you may have guessed, weathering is often caused by weather. For example, in places where wind patterns are particularly strong, such as deserts and coastlines, the wind carves out some unique rock formations through physical weathering. Some examples are arches, hoodoos, ventifacts, and mushroom rocks. Temperature also plays a role in weathering. For example, large temperature changes cause thermal stress weathering. This is when rocks expand and contract as they heat up or cool down, leading to cracks that eventually break the rock apart. And of course, when talking about the weather, we can't forget humidity and precipitation. This is where the atmosphere and hydrosphere team up to shape the land on Earth. To better understand how this works, let's check in with Ginny. Hey geologists, Ginny here at Mammoth Cave National Park. Remember, the hydrosphere includes all the water on and around Earth. It covers the majority of the planet, so it has a huge impact. And this park is no exception. Take this river, for instance. The flowing water combined with the sediment it carries grinds away at the riverbed and banks, continually reshaping the landscape through physical weathering. But the water here doesn't just carve rivers. It's also responsible for creating the cave this park was named after. Mammoth Cave. It's the longest cave system in the entire world, stretching underground for over 400 miles. But how does the water here create a cave so large? to get to the bottom of this mystery, we actually need to set our sights a lot higher. That's right, rain. Rain might seem harmless to rocks, but it actually has a secret weapon. As rain collects in the atmosphere and falls to Earth, it absorbs carbon dioxide from the air, which reacts with water to create a weak carbonic acid. This acid is capable of dissolving rock over time, especially carbonate rocks such as limestone and marble. This chemical weathering is why old marble statues often look worn down, and that's just from water running over the surface of these rocks. Now imagine what this water can do when it collects on top of rocks over time. Here at this park, over millions of years, the rain continuously seeped into the ground, invading cracks in rocks and dissolving them, carving the massive cave systems and underground rivers that exist today. This same chemical weathering process is responsible for creating similar caves around the world, as well as sinkholes and karst landscapes. Pretty incredible, huh? That's the power of chemistry. But water also causes a lot of physical weathering we haven't discussed yet. Fiona, that's your cue. Fiona? Hey, geologists. Fiona here, reporting from the Washington coast. Sorry I'm late. I had to change a flat tire because I hit a pothole. Did you know that potholes are mainly caused by physical weathering from water? Yeah. It's a process called frost wedging. As roads wear down, water seeps into the cracks. When the temperature drops, this water freezes and expands, putting pressure on the cracks and making them larger. Over time, this process eventually forms potholes. It's one consequence of weathering I could certainly do without. This coast, however, is a different story. I love ocean waves and the landscapes they create. The waves here are another form of physical weathering, constantly crashing against the shore, shaping cliffs, beaches, and coastal rock formations. This coastal weathering can create striking landforms, such as sea arches and stacks. A little farther north, we'll find even more evidence of physical weathering in the form of glaciers. Glaciers are massive, slow-moving bodies of ice. As glaciers move, they scrape and grind the rock beneath them, carving out valleys and shaping mountains. This process can create dramatic landscapes like fjords and glacial valleys. Pretty cool, huh? That's the physical power of water at work, breaking apart rocks and shaping the land around us. And speaking of land, it has an active role to play in weathering as well. To learn more, let's join Helen at one of her favorite locations. Hey geologists, Miiverse Helen here. By now you can probably guess where I am, right? I get to talk about one of my favorite topics, the formation of the Grand Canyon. It's a great example of how not all rocks are weathered at the same rate. There are several factors at play, including topography and rock composition. Topography is the shape and features of Earth's surface, including mountains, valleys, plains, and other landforms. On this map, the brown areas represent higher elevations, while the green areas represent lower elevations. The Grand Canyon is carved by the Colorado River. Geologists, by looking at this map, can you guess where this river is located in the Grand Canyon? Pause and record your thoughts in your notes. The water collects where the elevation is lowest, always flowing downhill. The Colorado River may have carved the Grand Canyon, but it is the land itself that determines the path of the river. Even the smallest differences in elevation can make huge changes over time. For example, the original path of the Colorado River was shallow, but over thousands of years, it steadily carved deeper and deeper into the rock, creating the giant chasm that exists today. Rock composition plays a crucial role in rates of weathering as well. Take a close look at the canyon behind me. Notice how the base is wider than the walls? Can you guess why? The base of the canyon is composed of older, harder rocks like granite and schist, which are more resistant to weathering compared to the softer sedimentary rocks above. Over time, these harder rocks keep more of their original structure, resulting in the wider base of the canyon. As we can see, the geosphere isn't just the subject of weathering, it influences it as well. Every rock formation plays a role in its own story, written in the rock itself for us to find. Back to you, B. Thanks, Helen. Let's briefly review what we've covered today. We've learned that physical weathering mechanically breaks down rocks, while chemical weathering breaks down rocks by changing their chemical composition. The atmosphere, hydrosphere, and geosphere all contribute to these processes in various ways, continuously shaping the landscape we call home. In our next lesson, we'll take a look at what actually happens to these weathered rocks after they're broken down. Until then, remember, this whole planet is one giant sculpture, and we all have a chisel, so don't underestimate the impact you can have. Stay observant, keep asking questions, and I'll see you next time. Hey, hey.